thanks for being here. Y'all go ahead and have a seat, and let's watch this together.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship at Bear Valley Church. My name's Kyle. I'm the youth pastor here. And whether you're joining us in person or online, we are glad that you're with us this morning. I want to let you know about a couple of things as our service gets started. If you're here with us, take a look in the bulletin that you got on the way in. One thing you'll see in the bulletin is this communication card. Whether this is your first time here, or you've been here a bunch, or if you just need to update some information after being away for a while, we hope you'll fill this card out and you can drop it in the collection area on the way out the door at the end of the service. If you're joining us online, you can fill out this card at bearvalleychurch.com/connect. We hope you'll connect with us today and share how we can be praying for you this week. Today is also Father's Day, so we want to say happy Father's Day to all the dads out there. And it's our graduate recognition and celebration Sunday. So right now, I'm going to jump out of the video and down onto the stage, and we're going to celebrate our graduates together.
So that song, you guys, behind the pictures of these babies who are, I'm going to cry. What's wrong with me? Woo, it's fine. Behind the pictures of these babies who are not so much babies anymore. And I just was thinking, do we all know that God is for us? We're telling that to our kids, but are we telling that to ourselves? So I don't know if you need to hear that this morning. I didn't get enough sleep. That's why I'm crying. It's sleep. It's not anything else. It's fine. God is for you. He is with you. He is completely and entirely and wholeheartedly in your corner. We're going to continue in worship this morning, and we don't even need to sing in order to worship him this morning. We can focus our minds on him, our hearts on him. We can remember his goodness and his faithfulness. We can think about and meditate on how incredibly powerful he is and how he is entirely in your corner. Y'all join with us. You can stand, you can sit.
The world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. And you came along, put me back together. Oh, there's nothing
Focus today, God. We want to be near you. We want to experience you. We want to understand you. God, we want to feel you and know your presence, not just in this place, in this room, but in our hearts and in our lives and in our families. We want to know your presence there too. God, be with us today. Remind us of how you love us. Remind us of how you're for us. We thank you. We worship you. We give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, dads, let's go ahead and get started, guys. Now, some of you have already let me know how uncomfortable you were in last week's meeting. So tonight, we're going to try to respect each other's boundaries.
What?
Tonight, we've also got a guest with us, David. And would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah, hey guys, I'm David.
David.
How many kids do you have, David?
None, at least not at the moment. My wife is pregnant, and she should be delivering any day now.
That's great.
Super. Oh,
great.
Awesome. Who'd like to go first? Anyone. Anyone.
I'll go.
Perfect. Todd, yes.
My daughter and I went to the mall, and she said she wanted to take the stairs to the second level. And I said, I don't trust stairs because they're always up to something.
Todd, I'm sorry that happened. I encourage you to try to resist the urge to make jokes like that.
My turn? Okay. Can I go? Okay. Yesterday, actually, my daughter got home and she asked me how my day was. And I said, well, a guy tried to sell me a coffin, but that's the last thing I need.
Oh, Jerry, that joke is dead on arrival.
Because it's the last thing I need.
David, how about you?
Oh, I didn't say
this is a safe zone. Just jump on in.
Yeah, I guess I'm just scared of being a dad. I'm afraid I'm going to start telling bad jokes just like my dad.
Well, it might be in our nature. We can fight against it.
Hey, speaking of nature, I tried to catch some fog yesterday. I missed. M-I-S-T.
Oh, you're a monster. This is where the boundary is.
I'm done.
This is where you are.
Hello? Really? Okay, yeah, no. Yeah, I'll be right there. That was Julie. Her water just broke. I guess the baby finally ran out of womb. I'm gonna be a dad.
Don't you think you should be going?
Oh, yeah.
So I told my wife she drew her eyebrows too high. She seemed surprised.
Okay, there we go. Well, happy Father's Day, guys. We celebrate all the fathers here. And, you know, it's hard to overestimate the influence that fathers have on the spiritual development of their children and also on just society at large, the ability to live in a peaceful world. So we thank you for you guys. I know for some of you, Father's Day is a hard time. And for those of you, we want to say that our Heavenly Father will give you comfort and peace. Well, I'd like to ask you to take out your bear notes and we have a great study that we've been doing, and for those of you who this is your first time, we just opened our building, you know, a couple of weeks ago, but we've been walking through this book called Unique. It's a manual. We've been doing it in groups, but you can do it on your own, And the goal of this is to discover your calling in life. By the end of this manual, and there's a lot of homework in here, let me just warn you. But anyway, at the end of this manual, the goal is to come up with two words that will identify your spiritual calling for life. Now, wouldn't that be cool if you knew what it was God wanted you to do in this world? Well, that's what this manual is all about. And if you're not in a group, you can do it on your own. We have manuals out there. They're $13. We just ask people to pay online. But on our website, under Life Groups, Kyle and Julia have made videos to walk you through this. And so you can do it on your own. It's quite an amazing study. Today we're talking about the gift part of it and what gifts that you have, because your gifts identify what God has called you to do, because he'll give you what you need in order to fulfill his plan, his will on this earth. So anyway, this is a great study, and for those who are willing to do the work, there's going to be a result that will be life transforming. Now, I want you to look at the top of this first page. There's a little chart here. Parker Palmer wrote this. He said, I realized that I was doing an incredibly noble job of living someone else's life. It is our hope that you won't live somebody else's life, but you'll live out the calling to which God has called you. Now, on this chart, it's a funnel, and at the top, there's a bunch of X's. Up there, write the words, can do. In other words, these are all the things that you can do in life, because everybody has a lot of abilities and talents and that sort of thing. There's all kind of things you can do in life, so those are the things you can do. At the bottom of the funnel is 1X, and that's what you must do. So write the words, must do. Here's the quote. I printed it for you in your outline. This is from Howard Hendricks, a Christian educator at Dallas Seminary, just right down the road. There are many things in life that you can do for God. And the more success you have, the more opportunities will come. You'll know more people, you'll have more resources, etc. But most opportunities are distractions in disguise. Therefore, find the one thing you must do for God. Okay, if you're not careful, you'll spend your whole life doing all the things that you can do and never find the one thing that you must do. Is there something in your heart that God has given you? Do you feel like that God has this plan for you, and you're on the way to discovering what that is? So we've been looking at the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah was a prophet. God came to Jeremiah, and he said, I want you to be the mouthpiece for my people. And Jeremiah said, no, there's no way I can do that. I'm too young. And God said, no, you're the one. And I'd like to say to each of you here today, you are more unique than you think. God has a special purpose for you. He has a purpose for you that's different than anybody else in the entire world. And that's what he came to Jeremiah to say. Jeremiah said, look, I'm just a kid. I can't do this. God said, no, you're the one. I want you to be the spokesman for the whole nation of Israel, because somebody's got to tell them that they've got to come back to God. So let's read this together. Now, little context here. This is in Jeremiah chapter 20. We've been looking at several things that happened in Jeremiah's life. But at this time, Jeremiah had been persecuted. He'd been sharing the message of God. He'd been telling the people, you need to come back to God. You need to leave all those goofy idols that you serve and come back to God. And so what did they do? They beat him. They put him in stocks. So here he is. He was beaten in the public square. He was placed in stocks right in front of the temple, so everybody coming to the temple could look at him and spit on him or whatever. And so here's the reward he gets for being God's spokesman in the world. And so let's hear the cry of his heart. I am ridiculed all day long. Everyone mocks me. Whenever I speak, I cry out proclaiming violence and destruction. So the word of the Lord, though, has brought me insult and reproach all day long. But if I say, I will not mention his word or speak anymore in his name, his word is in my heart like a fire shut up in my bones. I'm weary of holding it in. Indeed, I cannot. I hear many whispering, terror on every side. Denounce him. Let's denounce him. All my friends are waiting for me to slip, saying, perhaps he'll be deceived. Then we will prevail over him and take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me like a mighty warrior. And so my persecutors will stumble and not prevail. They will fail and be thoroughly disgraced. Their dishonor will never be forgotten. Lord Almighty, You who examine the righteous and probe the heart and mind, let me see your vengeance on them. For to you I have committed my cause. What we're hoping to do during this series is to help each person find their calling. Even under persecution, Jeremiah said, his word is like a fire in my heart, and I have to share it. Let's look over on page 2. Now, we've mentioned that you are more unique than you think you are. We've talked about over the last few weeks that you have a destiny, that God has a special destiny just for you and for nobody else. We talked about last week that sometimes you have to give up following after false ideas. Sometimes you have to let some things go in order to really follow the truth of what God is saying to you. So here's our big thought for today. You ready? Embrace God's calling grace. That's what we're looking at today. Embrace God's calling grace. His call. He has a call for you. We see Jeremiah's words in chapter 20 that he's about to give up on what God had called him to do. It's too tough. But he can't. He can't give it up because it's like a fire in his bones and he has to do it. In 1 Peter 4 is a passage that from the Apostle Peter about the gifts that God gives us. And he's saying, whatever gifts God gives you, you have to do them because he gave them to you to fulfill his destiny for you. Here it is, 1 Peter 4, verse 10 and 11. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength that God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. He kind of gives two generic examples of types of gifts. Some gifts are speaking gifts. And he said, if you have a speaking gift, then speak. That's your gift. That's what God wants you to do. If your gift is more in serving, then serve. Fulfill the destiny that God has for you. And you know what that destiny is by what your gifts are. Because whatever he gave you, he wants you to use those to advance his kingdom in this world. As you discover the gifts God has given you, you are in the process of discovering your calling. He's given you what you need to fulfill his plan. Point number one is this. Calling is what you can't help but do. Calling is what you can't help but do. Now for Jeremiah, he had a clear calling. Of course, he objected to being God's mouthpiece. He was like, no, I'm too young. I can't do this. But finally, he relented and he preached, but he was persecuted. And so he was sort of ready to give up. Verses 7 through 9, I'm ridiculed all day long. Everybody mocks me. Whenever I speak, I cry out, proclaiming violence and destruction. And so the word of the Lord has brought me insult and reproach all day long. But if I say, I will not mention his word or speak any more in his name, his word is in my heart like a fire shut up in my bones. I'm weary of holding it in. Indeed, I cannot. There might be times in all of our lives where, like Jeremiah, we like to give up, but we can't. We can't. The only thing worse than living out our calling is not living out our calling. When you're called to do something, it doesn't mean it's going to be easy. A calling is not an exemption from suffering or pain or despair. When things go right, that's nice. But when things don't go right, then it's easy to think, well, maybe I'm mixed up on this. Maybe I don't understand God's plan. But the truth is to take a lesser path, to renege from the plan that God has you, to take a lesser path is to give up part of your soul. There's something worse than suffering in this life. It's having nothing worth suffering for. Have you identified anything in your life that is worth suffering for? For Jeremiah, the test of suffering was what actually confirmed his call. Now, one of the things that we do here at Bear Valley, in order to advance the cause of Christ around this world, is to help plant churches. And so right now we're supporting 2 church planters in Canada, 1 in Tucson, and 7 in India. But here's the neat thing. These 10 church planters, they're supporting, by my count, at least 41 other churches. And so church planting is the statistically the greatest thing that can be done in order to reach new people and especially to reach indigenous people all around the world. But church planting is a difficult and painful work. Right now, most countries are still locked down. And so these church planters, especially in India, the only thing they live on are the meager offerings that they receive on Sunday mornings. But there are no Sunday mornings. So many of these church planters actually are going hungry. And so we've been sending money for food to many of our church planters in India. And they've been passing them around to other pastors. Also in India, in a few states, there is bitter persecution. So some of these church planters have been moving forward in their church. They finally get some people. They build a building. You know, they kind of gather together like old barn raising and build a building. And in some of these areas, Hindu terrorists have come and burned their buildings down. And Pastor Junior sent me a video a while back of a pastor and his wife. A mob of Hindu terrorists came, pulled them out of their home, stripped them naked, and marched them down the main street of town while they were hurling abuse at them and throwing things at them. It'd be easy to give up at that point, wouldn't it? But none of them have given up. As far as I know, not a single one of these guys have given up, because it's like a fire in their soul. And they can't give up. They have to keep doing what God has called them to do. Jeremiah was beaten. He was put in stocks. It was right in front of the temple, so everybody could come by and spit on him on the way into the temple. But he was calling them out for their idol worship. I don't really quite understand idol worship. Why would anybody carve a little idol, put it on the thing, and say, I don't believe in the real God, but I believe in this God. He's the one that's going to help me out. You know, it doesn't seem right. But he was calling them out for their idol worship. But I was reading in 1 Kings this week, and here's one little passage I ran across that is right along the story, even though it's before Jeremiah. It's the same stuff going on. King Solomon the wise, right, the son of King David, the greatest king of all Israel, he married all these wives from other countries. And the reason that he was marrying people from the noble houses of countries around the world as kind of a political alliance. And so he married, like, you know, all these hundreds of wives or whatever. But anyway, they brought their gods into Israel. And so it said in 1 Kings that in order to be nice to his wives, he built temples for their gods, it said, on the hill east of Jerusalem. Well, what is the hill east of Jerusalem? It's the Mount of Olives. It's the Garden of Gethsemane. And so here, King Solomon the Wise, one of the great kings of all time, here he is building temples to all these fake gods in the very place where one day Jesus would kneel and say, Father, let this cup pass from me. That is why Jeremiah was so ticked. Because here they were building these temples to gods all around and neglecting the one true God and turning their back on the one true God. Let's flip over to the last page. So, here's the question I want to ask you. So, do you have a passion in your heart for something that would advance God's cause, that would advance love and kindness in this world? A passion is a conviction, and it can be contagious because it withstands the test of pain and suffering. You know, the Latin root word for passion is the word pain. You know, like we have the passion of the Christ, the pain of Christ. Because it is through pain that passion is formed. Pain is not the opposite of calling. Pain is the incubator in which calling grows. And so point number two, convictions are what you can't do without. Convictions are what you can't do without. Jeremiah was in pain, not just physical pain, but his heart ached at the betrayal of God's people. They deserted the one true God for all these, you know, fake gods out there. Jeremiah had to stand by his core convictions and call people to return to God. He was persecuted for it, but he didn't give up. Because when you have a passion, it can withstand the test of pain and suffering. In verses 11 and 12, in pain he cried out, but the Lord is with me. like a mighty warrior. So my persecutors will stumble and not prevail. They will fail and be thoroughly disgraced. Their dishonor will never be forgotten. Lord Almighty, you who examine the righteous and probe the heart and mind, let me see your vengeance on them. For to you I have committed my cause. Your convictions, they're what you can't do without. Convictions are also called values. It's the why question of life. Why do you have to live for the Lord and fulfill your calling? Because your convictions force you to do it. You have to do it because it burns in your heart. One of the things that we're doing in this study is encouraging people to find a life verse. So I'd like to encourage you to go through the Bible, go through some famous Bible verses, and see if there's one that really speaks to you. Or if there's several that really speak to you that you're like, this is me, this is what I live for, this is my heart. And find a life verse, because in your life verse or in those life verses, you will also find your calling. Because God will speak to you specially in those things that are part of who you are as a person. And this is my life verse. I printed it out for you here. But life is worth nothing unless I use it for doing the work assigned me by the Lord Jesus, the work of telling others the good news about God's mighty kindness and love. Now, one of the ways that you discover what God's calling is for your life is through your gifts. God has given you gifts. He's given you spiritual gifts. And there are many passages in the Bible that talk about this, but one of them is the one that they use in our particular study here. There are five gifts listed, and these gifts, they're sort of leadership gifts, but they're also gifts sort of style. And so I want to share those with you. We're going to walk through those five. Here's the verse, Ephesians 4, 11 and 12. So Christ himself gave apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. Let's look at those five, and you can think about which one of these speaks to you the most. The first one is apostle, the sent one, to start new things. It's from the Greek word apostolos, meaning the one who is sent out. And the apostles are the ones who went out into new territory to advance God's kingdom. Did you see this week that a university expedition team in Pakistan ran across out in the middle of nowhere a 4-ton cross? Now, you know, Pakistan is a 97% Muslim country. But somewhere between 1,000 and 2,000 years ago in Pakistan, there was a strong Christian community, and they built this 4-ton cross that I guess used to be standing up. They found it lying down. But it's a Tomanian cross. A Tomanian cross. When we were in India, we found out about the Tomanians, the followers of Thomas. The Apostle Thomas, in 52 AD, set sail, and he went eastward, and he wound up in India, and he just felt like that's where God had called him. So he spent the rest of his life ministering in India. Today, there are millions of Christians in India. It's kind of a special, I guess you'd call it, denomination. And this particular group, the Thomas Christians, they all refer their history back to the Apostle Thomas. The apostles are the ones who are sent out, the ones who go and start new things. So that's one of these gifts. Okay, here's the next one, is the prophet. The prophet is not so much foretelling the future. The prophet is forthtelling the word, calling the world to justice. So Jeremiah, that's what he was, the prophet. He's calling the world to justice. A key descriptor for prophets is this: they understand the times and what people should do. Let's look at the next one, evangelist. Evangelist, sharing the good news of salvation and grace. They are the witnesses. They are the people gatherers. And they want to make the word of God easily understandable to the unchurched community. Those are the evangelists. The fourth one are the pastors. That is shepherding the flock, caring for God's people. The shepherds are the ones who keep up with the flock of God, seeing needs, encouraging others, providing care for God's people. And the fifth one are the teachers. The teachers bringing God's word and God's wisdom to today. The role of teachers is to bring the light of God's truth explaining and applying God's word. So how are you wired up? Does one of these resonate with you? In our manual, there's a website you can go and actually do an online inventory, and it will give you a printout of how you answer questions related to each of these five styles of ministry. Now, do you remember the great Sichuan earthquake in China that happened in 2008? It devastated parts of that area. There were over 200,000 landslides. Almost 500,000 people were injured or they died. But there were some heroes that emerged from the wreckage. One was a little guy, 9-year-old boy, Lin Hao. And he was walking down a corridor in his school when the quake hit. He and his classmates were buried in the rubble. Only 10 of his 31 classmates survived when the school collapsed on them. And two of them, Lin Hao saved. One of them was right next to him, and as he scrambled out from the rubble, he pulled his friend out, and who was unconscious, put him on his back and carried him piggyback out of the rubble and handed him over to the principal of the school. Then he went back and he found a girl under the rubble. He pulled her out unconscious and carried her out as well. And so he was celebrated as a hero, and he actually was walking, maybe you remember this, in the Olympics. He was walking in the Olympics right next to Yao Ming. Yao Ming's like 10 feet tall, and this little kid, it was kind of a funny sight. But anyway, the story of this heroism got out, and several reporters gathered around him, get this, and they asked him this question: why did you go back into the rubble? And he said, I'm the hall monitor. It's my job. And we got a job too. We could choose to live our lives outside the rubble, or we could embrace our calling and go back in, go back into a broken world, go back in where there's pain and where we risk rejection and we risk getting hurt by this broken world. But we do it because we have to. It's who we are. We're Christians. That's what we do. Let's pray and ask God to help us, okay? Our Father, we're thankful, Lord, that you've given each one of us a calling or callings. And I pray, Lord, that in this room, we would not neglect the study, the work that we have to do to discover our calling. But we would figure it out, and we would fulfill the calling that you have for each one of us. Lord, it is my prayer that in this room, you would send us out as your warriors, as your troops, to advance the kingdom of God in this world. Let us be sensitive to your will in our lives. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey again, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. I want to let you know about a couple of things before we go. First of all, if you haven't had a chance to fill out this communication card yet, go ahead and do that right now. Let us know that you're here. Let us know how we can be praying for you. And you can drop this card in the collection area on the way out the door. If you're joining us online, you can fill out this card at bearvalleychurch.com/connect. Now is also the time in our service where we take up the offering. If you're with us in person, you can leave your offering in the collection area on the way out the door. And whether you're in person or joining us online, you can give your offering at bearvalleychurch.com/give. The ministry of our church is still going, including all of our new online offerings. Even though activity at the church isn't the same as it was before the coronavirus came to town. We are grateful for your support and for all of us sharing together in supporting the ministry of our church. Thanks for giving today. And that's all we've got. Our worship team is going to lead us in one more song, so let's join in together. Thank you.
participating with us. We hope you have a great week. We'll see you next time.